Good morning. I'm Abby Williams with United to Learn. Thank you all so much for joining our spring meeting. As a network of 50 partners supporting almost 16,000 Dallas ISD elementary schools, elementary students, it does feel a bit strange to be alone in my kids' old play space this morning and not in one big room together with all of you. So we thought it might be nice to start today's meeting with a message from some of the members of the larger United to Learn family.
United to Learn has dedicated countless hours of community service, endless resources, and has provided extracurricular activities and opportunities for our students.
We build strong schools and united and engaged community members.
The result is accelerated student achievement, powered by a strong community of partners.
United to Learn is a group of talented and caring individuals.
They're passionate people from different backgrounds and different walks of life to help our children succeed.
I have met so many bright students who are so excited to learn. Seeing them is the highlight of my week.
When our schools and communities are facing adverse situations, United to Learn is an organization that we can always depend on to be there for our students, not only for their academic needs, but also their social and emotional needs.
United to Learn provides so many meaningful community engagement opportunities
that have changed how we learn.
They have brought us together in ways I would have never imagined.
I'm proud to support United to Learn.
United to Learn has truly partnered in our mission to erase the opportunity gap in our community.
United to Learn has motivated our students, encouraged our teachers, and inspired our community.
United to Learn is resourceful,
a helping hand,
results driven,
generous,
empathetic,
optimistic,
inclusive.
They have been there for us every step of the way.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
I am.
We are all United to Learn.
As part of United to Learn, COVID has impacted all of our lives in such different ways. Over the last 8 weeks, our team and over 475 volunteers, though, have been blessed, truly blessed, to journey alongside our Dallas ISD partner schools. Seeing firsthand struggles, resilience, and incredible inspiration convinced us that today you would want to hear from all of them. So, with you, with us, to share a few reflections on how schools and students are faring in response to this very unprecedented time are three of the most amazing Dallas ISD leaders. Ms. Lauren Cruzell is the school counselor at Sigaroa Elementary. It is a precious campus located in the Bachman Lake area and educating 575 young learners, where 98% of the student body is living in poverty. With over 12 years with the district, Ms. Cruzell is clearly a seasoned and wise educator, but folks comment on her big heart and her empathetic spirit. They say that's what makes her office such an inviting space and really a magnet, not only for her students, but the fellow teachers with her at Sigaroa. Mr. Potter is the principal of Walnut Hill Elementary, who's incredibly positive and child-centered mindset not only has served him very well through COVID, but also rang confidence through the entire Walnut Hill parent community as his school was forced to relocate. We probably all remember those horrific tornadoes that went through our community, and we're still recovering from last fall. And Walnut Hill had to be relocated miles west of their home campus. And then finally, Ms. Angie Torres, whose role as a Dallas ISD executive director leaves her responsible for not only those two campuses, but nine more as the coach, encourager, and leader for almost 6,700 kiddos. And as I've come to admire, Ms. Torres makes this all look very easy, although I'm pretty convinced that she never sleeps. But one of her principals told me just last week, as she is finishing also her own dissertation, that she really is the perfect research practitioner. because she represents the student voice with a level of interest and dedication that literally drives every single decision that she makes. Welcome to each one of you. Thank you so much for being here. We are living in such an uncertain time with evolving information on a daily basis. But let's just start with a quick check-in. How are you today? Give me just a 1 minute tour of, you know, day in the life of a COVID educator, living, working, and all of that virtually from home. Ms. Cruzell, start us off.
Good morning. I have spent a lot of my time being responsive, it seems, lately. In this ever-changing time, our families' needs, our students' needs, they are ever-changing as well. So I've spent a lot of time being supportive, looking for resources, and trying to spread as much good cheer as possible to our families in a time that is scary and pretty uncertain.
And how about you, Ms. Torres?
Good morning. I think for me, it would be I'm just more focused and more intentional, just making sure that I'm being that strong leader so that my principals can continue to be strong. So regardless of the situation that's occurring, we just, you know, have to be resilient and just very focused on what we're doing. So that's what's happened for me.
I've seen you guys really have to wear different hats, that you aren't, you know, the same educator that you were in the classroom. Life isn't so structured, so your role has changed. But I was really encouraged in hearing Dr. Hinojosa mention a couple of weeks ago that educators had made contact with 98% of students across Dallas ISD. It sounds like it took a little bit of creativity to make all that happen. So, Mr. Potter, tell us a little bit more about how your life has changed and maybe how this has changed for some of your educators as well.
Well, good morning, United to Learn family. Life has changed indeed, but you know, it's really shifting gears and looking at it as an opportunity. So within our network, within our cluster, we've really been focused on what that means to seize this opportunity to really prioritize social emotional wellness. And so that's really been another shift and paradigm shift that we really try to embrace. And so we try to do that in our own kids and families, and then also with our staff.
Well, all of you were significantly impacted by the tornadoes. So we sort of say, I think you've sort of earned your crisis stripes, if you will. Tell us more about parents and, you know, how are they feeling? What more support are parents needing as home teachers and family providers in this time?
One thing I would jump in and add is, like, it's been a mindset shift for educators. So thinking of it in terms of being asset-minded versus deficit-minded in our thinking. What do our families have and what do they bring and how are they demonstrating their dedication and resolve to education? Mm-hmm. We've had to shift gears as designers of learning to think about at-home learning versus homeschooling and what that means. And so really focusing on parent choice and designing lessons so they're accessible so that parents are empowered and kids can access it at an independent level with the help of our staff as well.
Great. You know, Ms. Cruzell, I think I've seen a few really cool videos of students. Maybe some morning meetings and maybe even a family Friday hangout. What is a morning meeting and how is that possible in this remote world?
So I will tell you, we committed ourselves to ensuring that we kept these practices in place. The leader in me has made a huge impact on our campus, and those practices have made a huge impact for our students, their families, and our ability to really teach the whole child. And so in a time like this, that is one thing that we found to be one of the most important things that we would continue with. So it was messy in the beginning, everyone trying to learn how to use the technology and some frustrations that came with that. But Now we have regular morning meetings via Zoom. We have regular closing circles. Some teachers are doing them daily. Some are doing them weekly. Mm-hmm. I join in on as many of those as possible. And now our family members are a part of those. So one really great thing that has come from this is our normal morning meetings and closing circles when we are on campus don't include our families. And now they do. And we are doing breathing exercises and going through our weeks and talking about our goals and things that we accomplished. And it's a great way for the students to connect, and now the families as well, with us, and still hold themselves accountable and share things that are valuable to them. So it's been a really great thing that we've been able to continue with even during this time.
Absolutely. That's awesome. And our team has loved the videos, and we have absolutely mimicked a lot of what your young students are doing by beginning each meeting with some breathing and getting focused. So thank you for teaching us all that. Ms. Torres, I'd love for you to talk a little bit about this. We're talking about specific strategies that are being used to build the social and emotional health of our campuses. And certainly the district overall has prioritized this. But I have watched you in particular have a real vision, not only for building this foundation, but in utilizing Leader in Me as a framework. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with Leader in Me, it's a curriculum that leverages Stephen Covey's highly effective habits and really unites students, families, and staff around what is best for kids. Can you talk a little bit more about your vision there? I mean, this is a lot of campuses to roll something like this out on. And I wonder more about the parental component that you saw in the Leader in Me framework.
Okay. So I believe because of the Leader in Me program framework, that the student voice aspect that has been developed alongside the strong parent connections with the schools they have formed, it has been very integral with the success of our parents and the parent component. We've always had that parent component on our campuses. However, due to this Leader in Me framework, it has not been as developed as we've wanted in the past. So I look at it as it's like a muscle. The more you use it, the stronger it becomes. And so we're now involving our parents in the many facets of the school, in the school decision-making process, that again, it just assists us with that parental component piece within that Leader in Me framework.
Mr. Potter, Ms. Crizell, can you tell us more about, you know, what are those individual strategies that you see parents accessing today? And I did read your newsletter over the weekend. You were talking a little bit about sharpening your saw. I'd love for the larger audience to understand what sharpening your saw is and how that came from Leader in Me.
So it's habit 7, and it really focuses on kind of taking care of ourselves. And some of the studies we've been doing in our own cluster is, what does it mean? What does self-care actually mean? It's, you don't want to, it wants to be balanced. You want it to be healthy. You don't want it to turn into indulgence, right? And so to the point to where it's not healthy. So it really, the thing about this whole response in terms of leadership is it really strips away everything that's a distraction and really focuses on people. So we're really working on our cluster, modeling within ourselves of working with Brené Brown's work and thinking about leading with vulnerability. So I'm on my own personal journey to model my journey to my staff, even more so about what Leader in Me means to me, and being vulnerable about that journey and saying, you know, I really didn't sharpen my saw as much yesterday as I wanted to. I'm going to prioritize that, and this is how. And it's a journey, right? So it's also helping our parents to understand, to mitigate stress and to focus on what is important. The tyranny of the urgent can cloud the important, distractions can cloud the important, and this is an opportunity where a lot of things have been stripped away, where we can really focus on meaningful learning in an important way that's great for us based on Covey and Leader in Me.
Ms. Crizell, are there other things that you are seeing, especially in this remote world, that you feel are drawing upon some of those foundations of the Sigaroa school community?
Well, I can tell you that prior to us leaving campus for an extended period of time, I watched the leader in me transform children. We had several children that were not very plugged into school, not very committed to their academics, highly frustrated when they were at school. And we were not capitalizing on strengths that they had. And the leader in me gave us the opportunity to do that. And because of that, because those students were given the opportunity to shine, they began growing and shining in areas that I think they once probably thought they couldn't. And so because of leadership opportunities students were given, they were excited to come to school every day. We did name our student lighthouse team and we coded them, and that was a very big ceremony for our students. And there's a lot of pride involved in that. And so our students now that maybe weren't so invested and interested in school want to be in school every day, are invested in their academics. We've seen test scores go up in students that had zero excitement about some certain subject areas. So it's not just a leadership program. It's affecting kids in ways that it may not seem that it could on the surface. And it's made things easier for the parents at home, because doing homework is not such a struggle anymore. And the kids are just very committed to the process, and it's gotten their families involved, and it's gotten them involved, and it's given them an opportunity to shine. And I think that that's really valuable when we're talking about educating the whole child.
Fantastic. And, you know, and I have read the research. We've all talked about the research that indicates that stronger social and emotional environments drive student achievement. I love that you are seeing in real time that happen, you know, week over week on your campuses. You mentioned the lamp lighter, the lamp team, the lamplighter team that you have formed.
Student Lighthouse.
I was thinking about another one of our partners, I think, when I said lamplighter. Tell us a little bit about that. And I know that one of your partners in parish schools, so many times, you know, we are accessing the community and institutions in our community to really get in this journey with us, campus by campus. Tell us a little bit about the role in parish in that work.
Our partnership with parish is something that I could never speak highly enough about. Parish supports our school in a number of ways. We have parish students and staff members on our campus almost every day. They support our Reading Partners program, but with our Student Lighthouse team, when we formed this team, we decided that we wanted it to be a very elite group of students. And what's interesting is we had the students interview for the positions, and we had three different positions available. We had morning greeters, we had the students that do the announcements morning and afternoon, and then we had our tour guides. So they were applying for one of those three positions, and they had to apply on paper and then interview in person. And so the great thing about this is that, you know, often when you see the leaders in schools, it tends to be the same kids that we see in different areas. And these are not the kids that were always the first ones chosen for things. And so, It was a really great opportunity for our kids. And I was so proud of our kids that stepped up, because that can be an intimidating environment to have to interview in front of adults. And they did it, and they did it with pride. And so we have 25 students on our Student Lighthouse team, and Parish donated. We decided we wanted to coat them, similar to how med school students are coated. We were going to coat our leader in me Student Lighthouse team. And we had a big ceremony where we invited the community, and Parish donated all of the coats to us for our students. So we wouldn't have been able to do that without them. And then of course, many of the Parish staff members and students came to the ceremony. So it was a really great event, and it was a great way for us to work together with our partners to make that happen.
Thanks for sharing that. And I know from hearing from Dave Monaco, who's head of school at Parish, that he and many others would say that Sugaroa is just the third parish campus out there in our community. So, and your campus is not the only one that takes their partnership with other schools and within the independent school community, as well as churches and businesses in the city very seriously. So thank you for sharing that with us. I want to pivot a little bit to talk about accountability. And I want to bring back another teaching from Leader in Me. The goal of always beginning with the end in mind. I hear so many of you speak of that. Mr. Potter, you speak of it so often. So recently, we all saw that not only would school be closed through the end of this year, but our Texas Education Agency Commissioner Morath cancels all STAR testing. So in many respects, that's canceling formal accountability around student achievement. Ms. Torres, across your 11 campuses, you have had standout student achievement. Dallas ISD has seen tremendous progress. But on these two campuses, even in particular, we've seen literacy achievement that today stands 50% above what is happening within Dallas ISD, and sometimes twice as high as our national average. So nationally, a lot of the statistics say that only one in three third graders is reading on a college-ready pace. And I know that on your campuses, it's basically almost double that. So there's been a lot of tremendous achievement. My question is, how do you continue to monitor the progress? How do you feel about losing the opportunity to probably share what would have been incremental current year progress as well? Or in the midst of all of these, all this uncertainty and change, was it really just a sigh of relief too? Ms. Torres?
No, I don't think that it's been a sign of relief. I think we were ready. We were ready to face all the wonderful things that we have been working on, and the, you know, just the success of all of our students and the hard work of the staff and principals, assistant principals, just everybody. It's our entire family. So a little bit saddened that we were not able to show all the A's that we could have had. But it just makes us be more intentional about, we're going to come back. Like Mr. Potter said, begin with the end in mind, is we're now planning for the back to school. And so our plan is to come back bigger and stronger and better for our students and the learning community. And so just watch out. You might see 11 A's, you know? So we're just excited to really come back and just showcase what we've learned and then some, and what we have in store for this upcoming year. So we're excited about that.
Thank you. Mr. Potter, would you add anything else that you're seeing from a specific campus lens? I mean, your campus has been, you know, recovering from tornado and getting resettled in a new location. So how does accountability feel on your campus right now?
I think the most interesting piece of this whole part, and I'll just say it very concisely, is that, I mean, most of our staff is in their third learning space this year, where they started at Walnut Hill, then they came to Tom Field, and now they're online, right? And so no one commits or follows a system. We follow things that we believe in, that we're committed to, that are a greater cause. And so while the state's not going to be evaluating us in terms of student achievement, and we'll have some shifts in our local accountability this year, what's the most inspiring thing to me is to see educators, not only in our school, but across our district, across our cluster, across our nation, stepping up and doing the right things and educating kids, no matter what, whether that's setting some Zoom conferences and some connection, doing SEL, asynchronous learning through Google Classroom and check-ins to help make sure our kids don't fall behind. They're still our kids. We're gonna have them in the fall, and the expectation is that we're gonna be on track and above.
Gotcha. You talked a lot about that third learning space, remote learning space, and technology is playing a role. I know that we've had many conversations around what that means. Technology can be a great divider and it can be a great equalizer. early after our stay-at-home protocols were put into place. We know that Dallas ISD did a study that revealed basically 35% of families did not have access at varying degrees to reliable internet. And then, of course, there was the issue of devices in homes. We also know that Dallas ISD has really championed this effort and tried to move as quickly as possible to get devices into every home, beginning with 12th grade and in high school, and then going through middle school, and finally thinking about third through fifth grade as well, perhaps by the end of this month. I believe that the same is true in terms of providing at least short-term relief on internet access. And I know that this is calling many to action across our community to think about reliable service for all and making technology a great equalizer. But before we get to those long-term solutions, talk to us more about the here and now. What is this meant for your students? What is this meant from, you know, device availability, sharing hotspots? What is the role that technology or lack of technology has played specifically in your school communities? Go ahead, Mr. Potter.
I would just say we've had to find ways to navigate this, and it's different for every campus, but we've just been able to track that and figure out what the need is. And the most critical component is that as a district, we've had to offer different ways for students to access learning materials and mm-hmm. to do that collaboratively with their teachers. And so, again, we want to make sure that family voice is part of this and family choice is part of this as well, because it's at-home learning, it's not homeschooling. We want to make sure the supports are there. But it has really challenged us as a district to think differently about what technology means in terms of access. And so we know that's very critical for our students to have.
Ms. Cruzel or Ms. Torres, are you seeing anything else that you'd like to share on technology?
Our families have embraced having to learn some new skills when it comes to technology. And they are truly doing that. They are embracing it, and they are sharing hotspots with each other. We get a lot of pictures, and I'm so glad that we do, because it's how we stay connected to our kids. We get a lot of pictures from our families, and we see students that are neighbors all in one apartment, you know, using the technology and using the devices and working together to get their goals accomplished. So I think it's really important for everyone to understand the amount of commitment that our families have to learning some new things that are outside of the norm for them, and the commitment of our students to get their work done. Our students are still tracking data in their leadership notebooks. We have a lot of really great things still happening, and the technology has opposed some bumps in the road, but not roadblocks, because our families are diligent and pushing forward and figuring out the best way to ensure that they're committed to their kids' education.
Well, I love that you guys are mentioning the word commitment, and you know that United to Learn is committed to you, to each one of you, and to the other 25 Dallas ISD elementary schools that we have the good fortune to partner with as well. You know, as we speak, it's almost 11:30, and volunteers are lining up at our food distribution sites that we have been implementing in partnership with a few of our church partners. That effort to supplement the resources that Dallas ISD and other local food pantries are providing for us, it will continue through the summer weeks. We've seen really hundreds of high school volunteers who have come out and created some remote learning tools for everyone, as well as now committing to virtual camps and tutoring. We've launched a book drive. I know in response to a request that we wanted to really build at-home book inventories for all of our students, just as our team is thinking about more specific professional development. But one of our school liaisons also remarked, you know, we're about to get into summer. We talk a lot about preparing for any summer slide. Now we've got COVID slide. Do you like where we're going? Do you think that these supports are where you want us? And while you have an audience of the community listening to us, what else should they know? What else should they know that you're working on? And what other ways do you wish that we were engaging with you and our campuses?
I can tell you that one of the things that's going to be the hardest as we approach summer is not closing out the school year in the way that we normally would. Summer is a hard time for teachers, and I think that that's a really important piece to understand. Summer is saying goodbye to our kids for a few months is a difficult thing, and knowing that the last time we saw them in person was March 13th makes that even harder. But one really great thing that has come from this is we are now, I was commenting recently that we're now in our students' homes where we wouldn't have been before. These Zoom meetings are putting us in our kids' living rooms with their families, and they're in our homes too. So we are now, I think, even more connected with many of our families than we were before. And I foresee that that will continue into the summer. I foresee that we will have end of the year class parties via Zoom. I foresee that we will still do a lot of the things that we do to bring about a little bit of closure. But I do believe that this pandemic has brought us into our families' homes and into their lives and them into ours in ways that would not have happened otherwise. The slide is a real thing, and it happens in the summer, and this is not aiding in that, but there has been so much education that has happened, and our teachers are so committed to bringing kids to where they need to be. That I just think that we will hit the ground running next year and be ready to perform in great ways, just as we would have had we been in the classroom every day.
Mr. Potter, do you think that we're focused in support where you want us? Where else would you have us shift?
You know, I think that we are. And I'm really convinced after having walked through the tornado and now the COVID response, that we're going to be on target. There's no doubt in my mind. We have a strong cluster. We have a strong team. I see that resolve of our district. We're responsive to that. Our community is too. They're civically engaged. I feel like in the city of Dallas that no matter what choice people choose for their own children, I feel like that people are supporting Dallas ISD and public education. It's a great time to be in Dallas ISD. And so I think we just continue the work and we move forward and we continue to partner step by step with the foresight for the future to get ahead of needs and to address emerging ones. And then we're going to be on target.
Well, I'm sure we haven't answered every question out there in this 30 minutes. So everyone listening in, know that you will receive an email before the end of the day today where you can submit your remaining questions. And I am so grateful to our three panelists who have graciously offered, we didn't even ask, they actually offered to answer any of those subsequent questions, and we will get responses back to you within the next couple of weeks. So thank you again, guys, for agreeing to do that. So as we're looking to the end of this first wave of the pandemic, and yesterday Governor Abbott announced that we'll be easing some of these protocols and thinking about our collective new normal, never a return to all of our old ways. So in that inevitable paradigm shift, I'd love for us to close by hearing a little bit more from each one of you on what brings you hope in that new normal, in that shift, and maybe what still keeps you up at night. Ms. Torres, can we start with you?
So I think what brings me hope is that our new normal has really caused us to have to take a step back and realize that things can change in an instant, and it's how you react to those changes that's going to be the important piece. We can't take anything for granted, let alone our academics or even the social emotional health of our students, our staff, or our families. So with that being said, we have all taken a look at the new way to take this pandemic into a positive light. So I'll give you an example. In our last principal meeting, Mr. Jaramillo made a connection to some of the work that we've been doing on Dr. Lori Santos, which is a Yale professor at the university. And we were listening to the Happiness Lab podcast. And so he said that, you know, he used that Zoom idea of the Zoom recording to do a parent meeting. And so he said that the way he's thinking about how to use this particular piece was to actually start to put the link onto the website so that parents that can't make specific parent meetings, that they'll never really miss it because they have that to connect to, and they'll feel like as if they were actually there. And so I think that just realizing that we have to look at things a little bit different, but in a more positive way, that's going to push us to the next direction. What keeps me up at night? That question is more about, am I as a leader doing enough for my cluster? Is our cluster doing enough to make sure that when our students return back to us in the fall, that we have all the supports in place to ensure that all our students are successful and they're continuing on from where they left off? So I think that's what keeps me up at night.
Well, Ms. Torres, I can tell you that there is no way that you're not doing enough. And I think that Ms. Cruzell and Mr. Potter and the other leaders that you lead would probably definitely agree with me on that one. So thank you. Ms. Cruzell, how about you? What do you think?
Something that's given me hope is the connections that have been made with our families. I think that when we return to school, these connections will carry forward. And I am really, I have a lot of positivity about the connections that have been made. I also am hoping now that parents have been really involved in their child's education, that that will continue. There's nothing like having parent involvement, and I really think now that the parents have been so involved these last few months that when we return back to campus, that will continue. Something that keeps me up at night is me not being able to interact face-to-face with the students. The things that existed prior to this, neglect and abuse and things like that, I still have concerns about. And now I don't see the students face-to-face on a regular basis. Mm-hmm. And I literally physically lay down at night and go through that list of students in my head, and that's a hard thing. It's a hard thing to not see them and hug them and know that they are okay or not okay and need support. Not being able to have that interaction definitely keeps me up at night.
That has to weigh heavy on your heart. There is so much good that I know that we are all seeing, but it's difficult to also hold and know of the circumstances that are out of your control, you know, when so many are doing well and are reaching deep in, being more resourceful, being more resilient. I love how you are helping us better understand the partnership that parents are digging into at this time, that maybe before just hadn't availed itself as it is today. And I'm sure your students are missing you as much as you're missing them. Mr. Potter, close us out. What do you think?
I think for much of the last century, you know, we've been really acclimated to the custodial function of schools and the role that they play in our society. And that's kind of become normalized, but this has been very disruptive to that. So I'm hopeful that we will emerge with a new outlook on how we can engage with public education, especially partnering with our parents and our parents partnering with us, as it's definitely changed that day to day. So I'm very hopeful for that and a shift and a renewal and a resolve around that. What keeps me up at night really is the idea that I just want everyone safe. At the end of the day, what I've learned this year, as long as our people are safe, our kids and our families are safe, we can do everything else. We can accomplish it. And, you know, slide and academics and accountability, there's no doubt in my mind that our school and our cluster can get where we need to be. There's no doubt in my mind there. At the end of the day, as long as people are okay, everything else is going to work out. So that's the priority.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Potter. Thank you, Ms. Cruzell and Ms. Torres for sharing some of your insights. I know that everyone really appreciates hearing about the new assets that this unprecedented time has allowed you all to really cultivate within your school communities. Thank you for allowing United to Learn and our team and our partners and our volunteers to be in this journey with you all. And to everyone out there, I hope that you can see that, gosh, we want you too. So come on in and join us. You can come together and support these fabulous educators. You know, we're only representing not even half of everyone that we work with every day. But everyone is going to be just as inspirational and resilient as those you've heard from today. You can visit our website for ways to stay engaged through our COVID response efforts with opportunities through the summer months, either virtually or in socially distanced volunteer efforts. And of course, like so many, we'll be participating in next Tuesday's North Texas Giving Day. And finally, we hope we will see all of you back on campus as part of our new normal next fall when we are celebrating Community Campus Day. Thank you all. Whoa, 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 whoa.